You know, as far as anyone could tell, Judy Feldkar led a normal life. Music teacher, wife, mother, active in her synagogue. But for more than 20 years, Judy had a secret identity.
If you would have said to me that I would be doing this, I would tell you you're mad. You're mad.
She grew up in Sudbury, Ontario, which is hardly a center for international intrigue, but she left to study musicology at the University of Toronto. So while there, she joins a Jewish student group, and she met her first husband, Reuben Feld. Together, they became active in campaigns highlighting the plight of Soviet Jews. But in 1972, a news report about 12 Syrian Jews who died trying to escape caught their eye. See, at the time, about 4,500 Jews lived in Syria, but they weren't allowed to leave, and they were constantly watched by secret police.
We thought that we had to do something about this, that this couldn't happen anymore to Jewish people.
And then Judy's life took a huge turn. Her husband died suddenly. At the age of 33, she was a widow with three young children. But that didn't stop her. Publicly, she lobbied Canadian officials to help Syria's Jewish population. Privately, she rescued them one by one, bribing Syrian officials to issue travel papers. Well, if the bribes didn't work, well, then Judy just smuggled them out. In all, Judy helped free more than 3,000 people, about two-thirds of Syria's Jewish community. For that, she's received several awards, including a thank you letter from Israel's former Prime Minister, the late Yitzhak Rabin. She's also received the Order of Canada. Her incredible story is told in the book, The Rescuer. There's her life, and ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Ms. Judy Feldkar.
Thank you.
How are you?
I am fine, thanks.
The Rescuer, how did this all start for you? How did you get into this?
It started because there were 12 young men who tried to escape from Syria in 1972. There was an article in the newspaper, the Jerusalem Post. It was repeated in the Globe and Mail in an op-ed piece. And I saw it and decided we have to do something about it. And what we could do about it was something that would be very difficult to accomplish, because the fact is, I knew nothing about Syria. I knew nothing about the community. I didn't even know where the community, Jewish community, was living. So it almost was falling in step by step into thinking, how can this happen? How can you sit in Toronto, mother of little kids, and my late husband, and figure out, maybe we should do something for these people?
But as you know, it's real life and not a movie, so how then, with that being a reality, do you figure that out? How does one start to broker a deal to try to bribe Syrian officials? How did you learn to do that?
You have to understand, the idea of getting people out was not even thought about. It was the last thing from what I would have ever envisioned. What we were trying to do was to make a contact. That community had been closed off from the world since 1948. So the whole idea was to get a contact. We knew we couldn't make a phone call, because that we investigated. We only knew what was done for Russian Jewry in the 60s and 70s, and because we were young and we were doing the usual calls to see to Sharansky's mother and paying for a call and sending a postcard. That was all, and we were young in those days, that's all we knew how to do. But what ended up was a communication system that was very well done, in a sense that we got a contact through a Montreal operator after making call after call to Syria to find out if there was a Jew in Damascus. We didn't know who to ask for. We asked for the head of the cemetery. We asked for the head of a school. We had no names.
You just get on a phone with somebody and say, are you Jewish?
No, we just made a call through to different countries with a man who spoke seven languages, because in those days, the phone calls had to go through Europe. There wasn't a direct dialing system. The Syrians cut the lines to Canada after the first call. So what we did is when she was working and we were available, we would make a time and we would call the Montreal operator and say, okay, let's try again. And she would do this. And this went on for about 2.5 weeks. If you would have said to me that it would end up into a rescue, I would tell you you were totally mad.
Right, so, but what I wonder is how does it get into a rescue? How do you then decide, how do you learn to operate like it's Jason Bourne stuff? How do you get people out?
What we started to do was to send telegrams in French, because we knew we can't, as I said, we can't use the mail, we can't make a phone call. We got the name of a man who happened to have been at home. I thought we were going to give this man in Syria a heart attack, and he gave us the name of the rabbi, the telephone number, and the name of the school. Now we had our first bit of information. We decided to send him a telegram and ask him, do you need any religious books in French, French being the second language? Never expecting an answer, we prepaid a $5 telegram. That was the link that started the whole thing, and for this went on for several years before there was even a concept. We had a link now into the country with the religious books. We were sending the books that he was asking for.
You had a sophisticated coding system, didn't you?
Yes. In the books, we started to put in a line from a psalm in French, like, peace be within your houses. That was how we found out that he got the books, because the telegram came back a few months later. The next line of the psalm, please, peace be within your mansions. Oh my God, we knew he had the books. Now we started another thing, which he picked up, because a lot of the Jews in Syria are survivors from Spain, from the Inquisition. And I had read a book on the Inquisition, how Jews became Moranos, and how they communicated with each other with these psalms. So we started with the psalms and the books till the Syrians picked that up. And then in the telegram system, we would have, he would send us the name before the address. He put in names of people who were in prison, and the verb went into the telegram where the books were listed.
And so then how do you go from that system to getting people out? Like, how do you then get people out?
What happened is a lady from Toronto went to Syria. She was originally from Syria. She lived here. She called me up and she said, I'm going to visit my brother in Aleppo in the north of Syria. He had been very, very badly tortured because some of his kids had escaped. And she said, I want to see him. I haven't seen him since she left Syria from the Jewish community in 1948. She went to see him. She was arrested by the secret police, the Mukhabarat, and kept in prison for a few hours. Mm-hmm. When she came back, she said to me, can you get my brother out? I had no idea how to do it. But then I started reading a lot of books on international intrigue. And in books, and in just thinking of what to do, because remember, I was doing this on my own.
You were at one point in the Jewish Defense League, which is at the best of times highly controversial, the JDL.
Yeah,
and I wondered, did you learn any of that, how to do in that organization?
Oh, no, not at all. No, we were, the Jewish Defense League in those days was a group of young people. We were all married, we had kids, we were fooling around with something to do. It wasn't...
Much later became serious, obviously, with the JDL, because this is a different time for you.
It was in its initiation
stage. So you're reading spy thrillers then?
I'm reading spy thrillers. I'm thinking at night, what could I do to get this man?